challenges that the nuclear energy industry is facing, because I think that the best way to overcome them is to meet them head on. Anna, you and I have talked a lot about broader EU acceptance for nuclear energy, and especially we've spent a lot of time talking about the green taxonomy. So what? Tell us kind of where we're at, but also what are some of the other benchmarks that you're looking for from the EU?
Well, indeed, we've been battling together, and thank you for all your support when we got the taxonomy. And I have to say that this has been a huge battle and a huge win, and a lot of credit goes to the Commission and to the President of the Commission, of European Commission, because they've been very courageous. The Commission has been very courageous to push this this piece of legislation, which is allowing the financial institutions to actually finance the nuclear projects, because we all know that those projects are a little bit expensive at the beginning, but if you look overall, in the end, it's showing that the sources, as I mentioned, from the nuclear, is one of the cheapest sources of energy and very affordable source of energy and very sustainable. So but we have other battles now to have the hydrogen from the nuclear. So, you know, the battles continue. And I have to say that our region, all the countries from our region are united in the front of promoting the nuclear as a source of energy in terms of the security as well. Some takeaways, I have to say that EU has been acting in a very unified and with a serious solidarity in the face of this unprecedented crisis, and managed to adapt and to adopt very strong and tough decisions and sanctions in a record time. The Repower EU plan, our response to the energy crisis unleashed by the war in Ukraine, the set common objectives to reduce the dependency on the Russians' energy imports, achieving the decarbonization objectives, it put the nuclear at the place where nuclear should always be. What are the takeaways? And some benchmarks. I think one is to never allow the energy in Russians' hands again. I think this is one of important lessons. Another lesson is don't eliminate one dependency and become dependent again for just from another source. So diversification. Another important decision that was taken at the EU level was to allow the member states to decide their energy mix. And I think this has been a very wise decision, because in the case of Romania, we mentioned the nuclear development that we have in Romania. So practically through those two power plants that we are operating as we speak, we are securing 18% of Romanian energy need. With the other two that are underway to build, and plus the SMRs, and with the SMR, we are in our site in Doicești, we are very advanced on that. So, I'm not trying to speak with a lot of subjectivity when it comes to Romania, but we've been, acting very, very professionally. And I have to say that Nuclearelectrica has been proven to have more than 26 years of high-level operation in terms of the safety, because safety is important. So another lesson from the EU point of view is that, we've been advocating that the nuclear, it's a safe source of energy as well. And I will end by just saying one thought. We need to make clear that the nuclear power is not in competition with the renewables. It could become complementary. And from that point of view of the energy mix, we do need to make the case, look, we are not in competition. We could go on the complementary. Don't lose sight of the social and economic benefits. So in short, I do believe that the EU is going on the right track. There are countries in the EU which to me doesn't make sense. You close the nuclear power plants, but then you open the coal. And you are advocating that you go for protecting the environment and achieving the climate change. But leaving that aside, I do believe that the common efforts of pushing at the EU level, especially in allowing the financial institutions and encourage the financial institutions to finance the nuclear power projects. And I will end by saying that we are very grateful. Nuclearelectrica is very grateful by the support given by the US Exim, by the DFC, because we've been talking earlier. You know, those, you know, this help is being given not just from the commercial point of view, but as I said, from the security point of view, because never lose sight that the energy in our region is always going to be a security measure as well.
Anna, thank you so much. And I'd like to stay on this notion of financing, which is often a hurdle for nuclear energy projects. Michał, I want to go back to you. Tell us again why you feel that nuclear energy is a good investment, and speak as well to this business model of the technical collaboration agreement, and whether this is something, you know, this idea of building and deploying multiple SMR units, whether that can be replicated in other regions and really around the world.
Great question. I believe that it should be a good investment. This is the reason why we're doing this. Not only one, but there is one of the reasons. In case of Poland and in our area, it's really difficult to fight an alternative to the nuclear energy. Wind farms and solar energy will not provide stable access to the electricity and heat industry, but also household needs. There is 14 million of the Polish citizens connected to the heat, to the district heat. I'm convinced that SMR, especially in built in large numbers, will offer energy and the attractive price, and became in the same time a good business. Recently, we have a few key players in the financial market which showed that they believed in our projects. Mentioned the Exim Bank, the DFC, the largest Polish banks, and the Polish National Fund for Environmental Protection. All of them give us the option for the further financing with the quite significant money. But to make it really successful, we have to achieve certain criteria in area of time and money. So we are basically believing and thinking about a quick development. 3 years for cooperation with national nuclear agencies and local governments. We already started achieving the decisions on two sides, basically with the deployment of six SMR possible, so six times 300 megawatts. We believe that SMRs have to be deployed in 3 years. The construction phase have to be finished in 3 years. The agreement which we signed, the TCA, and the modularization is a critical issue here, and we believe that we can achieve those times. 6 months for the synchronization with the grid operators, so we should land with the first SMR in 2 years. The time, it's both the money. So we try to limit it ourselves, and we believe that together with GE Hitachi, we can achieve the overnight cost not higher than 1.5 billion per unit. And TCA, and carefully choose partners who signed the TCA, give us the chance to do it. We need to have the financing in place, and we have a problem with financing long-term projects. SMRs, by the way, is creating the opportunity to be really short. So we are talking more or less about other real estate development, which usually takes up to 6 years in complicated projects. So it's not unique on the market to finance 6 years or long project. Anyhow, I believe that type support from the countries on the area of, for instance, CFD contract for difference will be really welcome. And this is, by the way, quite recognizable tool and used in different area of energy production. And on the end, you know, all of this should lead us to the potentially attractive cost customer in area of 55 to 60 per kilowatt production. TCA is an agreement which we signed together with the GE, Hitachi, OPG, and TVA. It's a part of the development of this business. The agreement should be beneficial for all the parties, but have a huge impact on the timetable. We all decide to spend basically $500 million to increase and speed up the process of development, standard design and detailed design. And the results of this agreement basically is to have the, from our perspective, have standard design, which is fitting EU standards. Hitachi is fully recognizable, state-of-the-art technology provider, most experienced company globally, with the great leadership and Dr. PGA, EVA, they are both nuclear fleet operators with great leaders, Ken Hartwick and Jeff Hidiash. So basically, we are newcomers, we are mostly the developers and the idea bringers. So we try to leverage on our great partners. And each of us is willing to deploy the fleet of SMR. And this should create for us the cost advantage and increase the speed of learning.
Michał, thank you so much for those insights. And you know, I think as we think about the Central and Eastern European region and kind of building this green wall of SMRs and of nuclear more broadly, you know, I think back to what Dr. Huff said a moment ago about moving away from Russian supply, and that Russia has shown itself to be an irresponsible partner and an irresponsible vendor. And so, Kornélie, I'd like to turn back to you because you talked about the tender earlier, and I believe, correct me if I'm wrong, you were referencing the Dukovany tender. And could you say more about the decision to, you know, leave Russia out or to not consider Russia for this tender, which, by the way, this decision was well in the making even prior to Russia's invasion of Ukraine?
Yes, indeed. So this decision was made in September 2021. It was actually included in so-called low carbon law, which also entailed and included some security guarantees. But of course, the question about security has been ongoing among the members of the parliament, senate, among the government. So, and of course, we're questioning, okay, is Russia a credible partner in an area of energy where actually the national security is involved? And the answer, as you may see, was obvious. But of course, we couldn't exclude Russia per se. However, we included in this law that only countries that are parties of so-called agreement on government procurement can be actually included in such tenders. And Russia is not party of this agreement. And this agreement actually ensures transparency, and we couldn't include Russia in this way. So, and of course, as the circumstances evolved and as unprovoked Russian aggression against Ukraine happened and is still ongoing and even is targeting energy infrastructure and weaponized energy sector in the hands of Russia, it was a really, really good decision. So I just really want to insist that it is really crucial to rethink of who should the partner be in when you're thinking of national security and energy.
Kornélie, thank you so much. And I want to move, I'm going to stay on the notion of moving away from Russia supply, but move a little bit to the fuel side of this. Branislav, recently an agreement was just announced with Framatome to provide fuel to VVERs in Europe instead of just using Russian supplied fuel. So could you shed some more light on that agreement, if you could?
Sure. It's actually not an agreement. We have signed just a memorandum of understanding, and it's not legally binding. However, it is the first step towards the diversification, developing alternative supplier based in Europe. So we and all four operators of the VVR 440 technology are speaking to the Framatome, and we are going to support and also finance the development of the new fuel. That's what is the memorandum of understanding about. However, we have to realize that development of such a fuel will take, you know, from 8 to 9 years, and therefore the dependence on the Russia will be still there for, you know, quite a long period of time. Even though at the same time we have run the international tender from which we boldly excluded whoever from Russia, so we excluded the Russian companies to participate in, both for uranium or all for components, uranium conversion, enrichment, and fabrication, and for the fabrication, which was the main component and dominant by the Russians. The Westinghouse is going to be the winner of the tender. We are just finalizing the last steps in process of signing the agreement. So we will have, what we want to do is basically go from Russian dependency to have two alternative suppliers. We do not want to go from one dependency to a new dependency on one supplier, because commercially and even from the point of the security of supply, we have learned that that's not the decision to do, to be dependent on one. So that's what we want to establish going forward. However, we have to keep in mind that it will take time. Unfortunately, the nuclear industry is not the one where the things happen overnight.
Yeah. Branislav, thank you so much for those insights. And finally, Dave, to you, from your perspective, how can we move away from Russian enriched uranium?
Well, it's the answer to that is a very tricky question. Obviously, it doesn't happen overnight because, you know, currently Russia dominates the nuclear fuel market with about a 50% share. And just for historical reference, if you go back to 1985, for example, the United States at that time was at about a 50% share of the global market for enrichment. And the market gradually diversified away from the United States so that it wasn't overly reliant on a single source of supply. Well, the circumstances today are dramatically different, but here we are in a similar situation with Russia, again, having that 50%, about 50% share of global uranium enrichment, and the key difference now is there's an urgency to stepping away from Russia, as you referenced. It can't happen overnight, obviously, we're Centrus, as I mentioned, is launching this program to enrich HALEU. And it's an important part of moving away from that Russian supply. But our project is demonstration scale, and the DOE is rolling out the HALEU availability program that will hopefully boost that beyond demonstration to better support the reactors of the ARDP program. But this reliance on Russia is really problematic. It takes time, it takes investment to replace it, and that's just to replace the fuel needed for the existing global reactor fleet. I mean, when we're talking about HALEU, which is what I had referenced earlier, you know, it takes about 5 kilograms of low-enriched uranium to produce 1 kilogram of HALEU. So not only do you have the challenge of replacing fuel for the existing fleet, you've also got these new reactor build programs that are coming online, the PWRs, the small modular reactors. Then you also have the problem of the of supplying fuel for the feedstock for HALEU. So it's just going to take, you know, sort of an all of government approach to provide the government support that's needed to ensure that we don't have excess volatility in stepping away from Russian enrichment. And it's going to take speed, urgency, and massive investment.
Thank you so much. And unfortunately, that's all the time that we have left. But I think that this panel conversation has really driven home the importance of the Central and Eastern European region for nuclear and for energy independence and also for decarbonization. And so with that, please join me in thanking Dr. Huff and also our panelists.
Thank you.
Thank you.